Can you kick us off with just a quick synopsis? Tell us a bit about the world of the innocent.
It's a very grounded world, even though we're in this supernatural sort of genre. It feels very grounded and it feels like it could happen to you. And that was one of the things that really attracted me. These are two kids from my area in Yorkshire and the most extraordinary stuff happens to them. But it's dealt with in such a grounded way all the way through it. And you just don't know what's going to happen next to them. But it's so believable as well.
Of course, this is a story built around two star-crossed lovers. Can you talk a little bit about what each of those characters have that makes them unique and the wonderful people you found to play them?
Percy and Sorica are amazing to play. I think it's very hard when you pick two people who don't know each other to put them together and to get that spark on screen. And we were there from day one with it. It was just very, very natural between them. Those actors brought so much to the part as well. And because it's... they're very grounded Yorkshire people as well. I think that translated all the way through and everybody can relate to them. And I think everybody's been in that situation at school with first love. So having that relatability throughout the whole series, I think's what's really made it land.
Can you talk a little bit about the locations and the visual language that you were keen to get into the story?
Well, we had Dave Proctor and Damien Paul who were DPing on it, and they were absolutely incredible. We wanted to do a really different style for this. We wanted to keep that Britishness about it, but we also knew it had to appeal internationally as well. So, and we had these unbelievable locations, and you know, we go out to Norway and the fjords, and it's beautiful. But equally, we've got beauty in Yorkshire as well, and then in the grit of London, and trying to merge all those together was a challenge. But we found a really, really nice look for it. And it feels like an 8-hour feature film. It's beautiful. I think the shape-shifting element is something that we haven't really seen before. And I know this sort of thing is popular, but this was done in a totally different way. And just the scripts as well. And where we end up, we're in Norway, we're in Yorkshire, we're in London. We could just go on this incredible journey. I think one of the best things about the show is the pace that it goes. It sets off in episode one and it just doesn't stop till episode eight. I mean, I've seen all the episodes so many times and I'll start watching when I can't stop still. So it's, it's going to be great. When you're deep down in it and it's tough and it's raining in Norway and we're battling through and the hours are long, you need good people around you, and everybody smiled all the way through and we dug in. Pleasure to work with Sorica and Percy and Guy as well, and it was one of the best productions I've ever been on.
At the heart of this series is a really intense love story. Can you talk a little bit about your amazing co-star and what you think is unique about this relationship?
I was surprised by the depth with which these characters were drawn, that it's not your typical teen romance. Yes, these are young characters, but their relationship is never shown to be shallow in any way or teen in any way. It's a very real, very complicated relationship. They are both very complicated characters, and I think that is a change in a way from how we see young people presented.
Talk a little bit more about who June is beyond the situation and the extraordinary circumstances she finds herself in, and what interests you about that character as a storyteller.
Yeah, well, in a sense, June is just a young girl trying to figure out her place in the world, which was very attractive and relatable to me, you know, because it's something that everyone, in a sense, can identify with. When you strip away the elements of shape-shifting, the elements of drama, the sort of more heightened elements, actually, underneath all of that is one young girl's sort of fight to figure out her identity, which I think is a very human issue and hopefully very relatable. 16, living in the middle of nowhere in Yorkshire, desperate to kind of see the world and experience the world for the first time, desperate to run away with her, well, the love of her life. So at the beginning, when we meet her, she's very, in a sense, naive, but very optimistic and open-hearted about the possibilities of the world, which obviously gets turned on its head quite quickly once she discovers that she's a shapeshifter. For sure, what drew me to it initially was the sort of character arcs in it. Yes, it has elements of sci-fi, but at its core, it's really, it's a really real, very raw story of human relationships and human feelings and responses to circumstances. So I think it's a very character-driven piece in that way, which I hope will be exciting for viewers. for sure, anytime there's that much science fiction sort of CGI elements, it can be difficult. But we, our show treats it very much as a very real issue. It's treated as a medical condition, not, it's never sci-fi for the sake of sci-fi, which I think always helps it feel really grounded. And as an actor, it really helps the performance of scenes like that, that we're not playing up to the sci-fi. We are focusing on the relationships and what these characters are going through, and kind of, in a way, can forget about all the other dramatic elements. A story about love and about the search for identity and how difficult it can be to be young and to find your way in the world at its core. I mean, obviously, then there's some science fiction, there's some shape-shifting, there's some drama, there's some great Norwegian locations. So, in a nutshell, that's it.
Can you tell us a bit about your character and what, beyond his extraordinary circumstance, makes him such an interesting character to unpack?
That's such a great question. So I play a character called Harry Polk. He's a 17-year-old guy, and the best way to describe Harry, he's the kind of guy to make the most noise in a room, but he's often the loneliest inside. And that, for me, struck a chord when I first read the scripts, because I feel like we all are ever-changing, ever-growing, and especially at that age where you can all remember trying to find out who we are. And I think that's the most exciting time about life as well. It's about making choices about who we are. And at the same time, we make certain choices and then we must see what happens in terms of the consequences. And that's about growing, that's about learning. And I don't think we ever stop doing that, you know. And it goes back to the show. I don't think it's about a show that's for a younger audience per se. Or I don't think it's a teen romance. I think it's much more wider than that. It's about identity and people searching for themselves and being comfortable in their skin. And I feel like that, for me, was why I gravitated towards Harry. And out of the extraordinary things, I think, quite simply for me, it's just Harry's choices that strike me, and for why it was intriguing. It was the relationships that he has with his mum and his dad, and that's something new, and it was also challenging. So I just felt like, yeah, that was why I'd, you know, wanted to be attached.
You mentioned romance. It's not all this is about, but it is a big component. Can you talk a little bit about why these two characters need each other so much and what your experience was like working with your beautiful co-star?
Yeah, no, absolutely. Like I said, it's about characters searching for who they are, and ultimately for Harry, he runs away because it's about the freedom to, you know, wanting to be himself, but at the same time overcoming the responsibility of, you know, of that pressure of looking after and catering for his dad. He, you know, he wants to work out who he is and find out that, you know, and I guess June brings out that, you know, June is his escapism. You know, she's the only person who can see Harry for who he is, and I feel like that's the one thing that you want in a partner. And working with Soroka, it was amazing. It just was. I feel like, you know, when we first did the audition and the chemistry tapes, it just clicked, and we both went on this journey where we're both overwhelmed and we were anxious and we would confide in each other. And it's quite similar to the characters, really, the fact that they are learning, growing and sharing so much, and dependent on each other as well, you know. So I feel like that sums up my whole experience. I did a show called Wizards vs Aliens when I was about 18 years old, and that was with the Doctor Who guys. So I had a very small experience about how it works and stuff, but ultimately, you know, when we use sci-fi, it wasn't, a green screen that comes in halfway through the shot. It was about us physically working out the performances, the emotion, and then we apply the shifting aspect to it, you know. So, and we did that, you know, we had amazing locations, like you said. You know, we was in Norway, Yorkshire, London, and each location gave a different energy, different feel to the show. And I feel like even in the shifting aspects to it as well, it has a different tone as well, you know. So ultimately the show is very grounded in the fact that's about the relationships, and the shifting and the sci-fi is added on top of that. It's not a teen drama. It's as simple as that. I feel like it's its own show, in the fact that I think shape-shifting, I feel like it hasn't been tackled in the way that we've done it, and just ultimately the story. But I feel like Netflix allow us to have the creative freedom to create whatever shows we want to create, you know. And I feel like Netflix, I mean, The Innocents can't be pigeonholed into anything, really. I feel like it's, yeah, it's its own show, and I feel like when audiences do watch it, they'll see that.
We wanted to get the balance right about how the supernatural and the domestic interlock, and I think a lot of shows, once they hit on their genre, allowed that sometimes to, for my taste anyway, maybe outweigh the domestic and the real and the emotional. And what we always say to each other is we wanted to write a show where you could take the supernatural element out and it would still work. There's still a couple who have repressive home lives who go on the run and face these obstacles and have to, you know, will their love survive? And so I think it was about keeping the balance of that right always.
Definitely. And making it feel real. Like if this actually happened in the world, what could happen in that situation? To not make it too much of a superhero film or high fantasy. So to sort of explore that in a really real, grounded, sort of realistic way was really important too.
She's not a superhero, but she doesn't want the gift that she's been given. I think that distinguishes her from a lot of other kind of supernatural superhero style characters.
Just ask about the casting process, particularly for your two leads, and then of course the addition of Mr. Guy Pearce, always a welcome one.
Yes. It was rigorous, it was relentless, it was exhaustive. Our casting director, Daniel Edwards, is a phenomenal force of nature. He went to agencies, drama schools. I mean, he really...
Up and down the country.
Up and down the country. We had very few parameters on who we were looking for Harry and June. We just knew the qualities we wanted them to embody and be able to show on screen. So we looked at an enormous pool of acting talent. And I've got to say, the quality of acting of young people in the UK is so phenomenal. So it was a joyous, if very exhausting, process for everyone. And when we hit on
when we found them, we knew
Stalker and Percy.
We knew we'd found them.
Yeah, that was it. We saw them together and, yeah, something very special happened. So it was great.
There's a lot to say, really, and probably more than I'm capable of actually saying, hence the reason I play characters rather than talk about them. But, you know, I play a doctor who's trying to get to the bottom of a mysterious condition that, you know, is only affecting these women in this bloodline in Scandinavia. So... just a fascinating journey to go on, really. Farron, our director, was really clear about, you know, how he wanted to present it, and that it wasn't to sort of sit into sort of typical sci-fi world. He wanted the condition to feel like a genuine medical, totally feasible sort of condition, even though it's rare and unusual and, you know, not like anything any of us really experience in this world. So knowing that he wanted to present it in that way, I was really interested in it. So it was, you know, it was like we were just sort of treating a very unusual medical condition. Yeah. Well, I don't really prepare, to be honest. I just learn my lines, you know, and I think if all the work's there in the script, then you don't have to prepare anything. It's you're just inspired, you know, and off you go. So my preparation is reading and feeling and understanding and just doing it. Yeah. We were out in the sort of west coast of Norway in the fjords in the mountains filming, so it was quite spectacular every day, and you know, with very dramatic changing weather, so you never quite knew if you were going to get sunshine or torrential rain, and it really says a lot for... It sort of speaks to the world that you're in when you're actually in a very dramatic location like that. So it was spectacular, yeah. I didn't hear a lot before I read the script. I mean, I heard about it and they said the scripts are on their way, and I read them and loved them and said I want to be involved. So it was all very quick, yeah.
And what was it about your character in particular, who is kind of the probably like antagonist of the whole drama that these two star-crossed lovers kind of ensue? What was it about him that made you think, yes, I want to get my teeth into this one?
I just think the two extremes of his personality, which are, you know, one is that his sort of ego is really driving, you know, and him, and the fact that he wants to be the one to actually uncover this mystery, you know, this genetic malfunction that these women are burdened by. But also he's altruistic and he wants to actually help them as well. So, you know, there are two sort of two ends to the spectrum that are working in opposition with each other. So it was interesting to play. you know, he's driven to sort of help these women, but he's also, you know, he's also compelled to get to the bottom of this condition so that, you know, he can be the one he wants to, I suppose on some level, even if he doesn't realise it, he wants to be the one to make a name for himself, you know, because of it.
You just talk about working with your two young and incredibly talented co-stars on this production.
They were great, yeah, Percy and Zorka. I mean, all of the actors on the show were really wonderful to work with. And, you know, watching these two, I mean, funnily enough, most of my work was with our other ladies. So sadly, I didn't get to really experience Zorka and Percy until later on in my process of shooting. But, yeah, they were delightful, yeah.
There seems to be such a profound and primal connection in our best storytelling between love and fantasy, horror, the supernatural. Why do you think that is? Why do you think we so often see these themes tied together as this series so beautifully does?
I have no idea. I have no idea about the supernatural and horror and all that. It's never something I'm delving into, so I wouldn't have a clue how to answer that, to be honest. But I do think that the idea of identity is an interesting one, and you know, us trying to sort of identify ourselves every day in life is a question that we come up against all the time. You know, one day we feel good about ourselves and the next day we don't. So you know, I think that idea of identity, and particularly within a relationship, is good fodder for drama. Yeah.